any concern in the course, anything, you can ask me right now. Let me start. Slides are visible, guys?
Yeah,
okay, let's start. So chapter number three is, what is chapter number one? Anybody can tell me? Chapter number one was about what?
Information system.
Yes, in general. Chapter number two? Chapter number two.
I think it's about the business and around the number then.
Organization.
Yeah, organization.
Okay. So can you tell me the definition of information system?
Collecting of data, doctor?
No, I need the proper definition. That is written on the slide.
I think, doctor, is data has been input and processing and show as information.
You're talking about the system. So information system, you know, we discuss it is the collection of people, databases, software, hardware.
Yeah.
And I told you that this definition will keep repeating every time. Okay? And just collection of these things to solve the problem to achieve a goal. So this is information system. Now in that collection, we discuss about the people, we discuss about the software, and we discuss about the databases, and one of them is hardware. Got my point?
Yeah.
So in this chapter, we'll focus on hardware. Maybe the next chapter will be we will focus on software. After that, we will discuss the databases, the people. So we will discuss all the component, which is the part of information system. Okay. So today we are going to discuss the hardware, input processing, output, and storage devices. It's an easy chapter because as its name shows, most of the thing that you are already familiar with this stuff. Let's start. So each computer processes its input through one or more central processing unit and memory store. So it's talking about hardware for processing. The processing units. You know the processing unit?
Yeah, that's it. I think.
Inside the CPU, which we normally call the CPU. So the CPU is a box. Do you think it is the box is CPU of a computer?
It is chips, doctor.
Yes, very good. It is a chip that is situated on the, located on the motherboard, right? So each computer processes its input through one or more central processing unit and primary storage. What is primary storage?
Hardware storage.
Primary storage.
RAM and ROM.
Yes, the RAM, okay? So CPU and RAM, they are working closely with each other, okay? Now CPU, central processing unit, what is the functionality? As it says, it's processing unit. You will give the input and it will process it and show the output. Okay, this is the definition of system. What is system? You will give the input, processing, output, and feedback, right? So between the second step, processing, so you need some machines, you need some mechanism that process your query. You will send a request through keyboard and CPU will process it and send it to the output unit. Am I right? And meanwhile, you need some storage area where you can store the information. temporary and permanent. Okay? Is that clear, guys?
Yes. Doctor, and primary and what?
CPU and CPU and primary storage. We're talking this.
Okay, okay.
Okay. CPU, central processing unit, consists of three associated elements. So they have further three associated elements. On this chip, you can find three more, the unit. Arithmetic logic unit, ALU, performs mathematical calculations and makes logical comparisons. What is logical comparison?
Like more than, less than.
Yes, it's comparison, more than, less than. You know the gates, I don't know, you know this, and, or. Gates, have you heard?
Or, and not.
Yes, so these are the logic gates in electronics. You will study all these things. So this unit is responsible for these logical comparisons, greater than, less than, equality, not. Okay, if both are true, then true. If one of them untrue, so it is untrue. So there are different comparisons. So ALU is responsible for that. Control unit, this is very important unit in CPU, sequentially access program instructions, access the program instructions, decodes them, and coordinates the flow of data in and out of the ALU. Registers primary and secondary storage and various output devices. So there are, as you read this point, control unit, so there are different steps. Sequentially, what is sequentially?
Like step by step.
Step by step, tartib, am I right?
Yes, order.
Order, access the program instructions. This is first step. So first step is fetch instruction. Second step is
decode them.
And the third step is coordinates the flow of data in and out of ALU, registers, primary and secondary storage, and various output devices. Okay, so control unit mechanism depend on three steps. I repeat, the first one is, what is the first one?
Access instructions.
Yes, we can say it technically, fetch instruction. Okay, second step?
Decode.
And third step is the communication and coordination between different unit of storage and output devices. So in short, you can say execute. So fetch, decode, execute. You got the functionality of control unit?
Yes.
Okay. Any question, guys, regarding this? Because when you press on the keyboard, okay, so this instruction will go somewhere, maybe in some temporary storage. Control unit will take this instruction, because when you press A from the keyboard, so computer don't know the A. What is A? Am I right?
Yes. I think it's coding it.
Yes. Anybody know the code? What kind of coding?
Binary.
Yes, it's a binary coding. Well, actually, it is called ASCII code. So there are different encoding schemes in the computer. You know, before we have ANSI, ASCII code. Now we have a Unicode available. So what is the ASCII code for A? Capital A is different. Small A is different. Maybe the 65 is the capital A. Yes, you're right. So this 65 will be converted into the binary digits, because the computer only know one language, 0 and 1. Okay? And then the control unit will, fetch the instruction, which is A, then decode, and then it coordinate with the different units. or maybe the different devices. This is how control unit works. Registers, you know the registers we already discussed. It's a small memory. It's very fast. Okay. Our high-speed storage areas used to temporarily hold small unit of program instructions and data immediately before, during, and after execution by the CPU. You know, we have different kind of memories, registers, cache, RAM, hard disk. So register is the smallest memory. That is
highest of speed.
Yes, very high speed and very expensive as compared to other memories. It is closely located to the, you know, the control unit, as it is the part of actually the CPU.
The CPU.
Okay, so it will hold the program instructions. So and the data that is immediately required before and during and after execution by the CPU. So is that clear, guys? In short,
yes.
What is CPU? Consists of three elements: ALU, control unit, and
registers.
So we can say the main, the core, the critical part of the computer is this CPU. Am I right?
Yes.
Because everything is done by this CPU. This is computer actually. Okay.
Doctor.
Yes.
Memory for a register. How I can find it? Or I buy it, or it's on.
It's a very small, you know, located on.
Inside the CPU.
Inside the CPU.
Yes.
Okay, it's a smallest memory.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
So as I discussed to you, the hierarchy of the memory, that's the biggest memory in size is the hard disk. Then we are moving to from hard disk to RAM.
ROM and RAM.
Between them, there is virtual memory. Sometimes, you know, your hard disk is full. So CPU consider some part of the hard disk as a virtual memory. Okay. And from RAM, we will move to the cache.
Yes.
Level 2, level 1, and then we will move to the register. So these are all memories. So moving from hard disk to register, you will observe that the size will decrease. Size will get smaller and smaller. Speed is higher and higher. Prices also higher and higher if you move from hard disk to register. Am I right? Did you get this point?
Yes.
Okay. Smaller in size memory is more faster and more expensive. Okay. So if CPU needs some data, it will check the registers. If it did not find the data in register, it will jump to the cache. Then level 1, level 2. If the data is not available in cache, it will jump to the RAM. And then hard disk. So this is the flow of work. Is that clear?
Yes, doctor.
So here is, you can see the block diagram, the hardware components. Right in the middle, we have, you know, the processing devices. You can see the control unit, arithmetic logic unit, register, and storage area. Then we have a primary storage, and then we have a secondary storage. So these are all hardware devices can communicate with the processing devices. So this is how it works. Okay.
Okay, doctor.
Hardware components in action. The instruction phase. step one, fetch instruction. Step two, decode instruction. This is overall called instruction phase. So when I say instruction phase, it means there are two steps. Slide is freezing.
Yes.
Okay, so instruction phase is, when I talk about the instruction phase, it means two steps. Fetch instruction, decode instruction. The execution phase, there are also two steps, which is called execute instruction and store results. So instruction time is known as I time, execution time known as E time. Have you heard these things before? Any idea?
Actually, no.
So this is actually the CPU and the control unit that we discussed usually work inside with the instructions. So we can have many instructions in the computer, and how CPU process those instructions. So there is some mechanism for that, right? Computer don't know, the general language, the high level language. It's machine learning that only the binary language that the computer understand. So you need some mechanism for managing the instructions, and the instructions are keep coming. There are many instructions that keep coming. So there are many algorithms are running in operating system. The scheduling algorithm usually schedule the instructions, and in CPU, so you must have some, this is called the technology, kind of the architecture. We're talking about architecture level. What is the architecture in CPU in general? If somebody asks you, so you can tell that there's an instruction phase, there's an execution phase. Okay, now these architecture has been improved over the few years, over the past few years. We have very latest architectures. The latest computer is very fast now. Do you agree with this?
Yeah.
Why they are fast?
The processor nowadays are much better.
Because these specifications that you are right now seeing on your screen, these steps are improved. Okay, in other words, they have some new methodologies for managing these instruction and execution phase. That's why they are fast. Okay, this is generally called pipelining. Fetch, decode, execute. This is called pipeline. This is three steps. So we can have five stages, we can have seven, we can have nine. And now the scoreboarding is also another technology. And currently we have a MIPS architectures. So you will study this in computer architecture course in detail. So right now you need to know that these hardware components, usually these steps are involved in CPU to manage the instructions. Did you get my point? Are you with me, guys?
Yeah.
Yes,
doctor.
We got it.
Okay. I can't open the chat here. I'm sorry that I'm fine nowadays. Okay, so I press the from keyboard. This instruction will be taken out, fetch instruction, then decode, then execute, and then store results. That's why if we go back to the previous slide, you can see the processing device, control unit, processing arithmetic logic, storage area. They have storage area, register, and memory. So fetch, decode, execute, and store. Okay? So different devices are connected, the output devices, the input devices. From input devices, you can take the input, they will process it, and they will show you the output, and they will store here. Okay? Is that clear, guys?
Doctor,
Yes.
Are you in side 6 because it's freezing in side 5?
No, I am on slide 6. Can you see?
No. Yes. Now we can.
Okay. So there's a machine cycle. What is this cycle? So first let me read on this what is written on the description. Execution of an instruction. In the instruction phase, a program's instruction and any necessary data read into the processor. Then the instruction is decoded so that central processing unit can understand what to do. Arithmetic, and then the results are stored in the register, in memory, the instruction and execution phases together make up one machine cycle. So this figure is representing the same thing what we discussed in the previous slide, which is this one. This is your machine cycle complete. If I ask you what is the machine cycle, the instruction phase and the execution phase all together making one machine cycle. Okay, did you get this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
And the time, doctor, it's not with it?
Yes, the time. You know, the time, for, you can see the I time and E time. For doing any operation, there will be a specific time. This is I time because it is instruction time, instruction phase time. Okay, fetch instruction and decode instruction. The time required to do this is called I time. Okay, execute and store, the time required for that is called E time, execution time.
So okay, doctor,
yes.
What's the order for I time and E time? Because in the previous slide, they listed in the last.
No, I mean, there is no order.
There's no
instruction time. Instruction time, if you are in phase one, fetch instruction, decode instruction, the time required for this is called I time.
Okay.
And the time required to do the execution instruction and store results is called execution
E time.
Time,
okay.
E time.
So just... item the last or the
yeah,
so
just
the instruction phase
and because it is the part
I just mentioned them.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So now if your computer is very fast, so it means your computer is able to perform some processing in minimum cycles. You got my point? Why your computer is fast? Because he can do these kind of processing in minimum time. Did you get this point, guys? We have a modern computer very fast. Why? Because their processing time is very, you know, efficient. The control unit, the storage mechanism, decoding. That's why these computers are fast nowadays. Did you get this point?
Yes.
In one cycle, how much time is required and how many instructions it can be processed. This will decide the computer is fast or not. Okay. Yeah, there are other factors are also the type of hardware you are using, built in, which companies. These things also matter, but the main logic of architecture is this. Computer architecture. What is computer architecture? This is computer architecture. Okay.
Doctor.
Yes.
Can you say again what's the order here?
You know, the numbering is there already if you see on the slide.
Okay.
Fetch, decode, execute, store. Okay.
Okay, I get it.
So this is extra memory, the RAM and the hard disk. When registers don't have spaces and the cache don't have space, so you are going to store here. it will go in cycle. So it takes time when you are bringing, now see the fetch. The data is coming from the memory. It will take time. Then it will decode, then it will execute the ALU, then it will store. There is no space on registers, so it will go on the memory. Okay, so this will complete one cycle. So if your computer is fast, if your computer can efficiently do this job in less time, one cycle, how many instructions can be processed? So this is the speed of the computer. Okay, moving to the next concept, primary storage. Primary storage or main memory provides the CPU with a working storage area for program instructions and data. The chief feature of main memory is that it is rapidly provides the data and instructions to the CPU as it is closely associated with CPU. So main memory, you know the main memory, I do not need to explain that. I'm expecting everybody knows.
Yes, RAM. The one.
You guys have seen the RAM? What kind of RAM?
Yes.
So now there are different types of RAM. We'll see that. So it is closely associated with the CPU. So chief feature of main memory is that it is rapidly provides data and instructions. CPU needs data, RAM will provide rapidly. Main memory devices contain the thousands of circuits imprinted on a silicon chip. Each circuit is either conducting electrical current on or off, known as binary digits. So each circuit is either conducting electrical current on and off, known as binary digit, 0 or 1. So it is a silicon chip, and you can see the circuits if you have experience to get a chance to see the RAM. So it's a silicon chip, there are circuits on that. Okay, and it works with the bits. Data is stored in memory as a combination of on or off circuit states, with each character represented by 8 bits. So if I say that any data that will be decoded into, for example, A is represented by 8 bits. Okay, 00010. Something like that. Okay, this is the pattern for storage the data in the memory. So 8 bit is equal to? Anybody knows?
1 byte.
1 bytes.
1 byte. Okay. And 1024 byte is equal to?
What the film?
Do you mean 128? What?
1028.
1024.
1024.
Is equal to
1 kilobyte.
And so on, 1 gigabyte, 1 terabyte, and so on. It holds the program instructions and data immediately before or after the register. This is an important point. It holds the program instructions and data immediately before or after the register. Okay? If register don't have enough space, it will talk with the cache. If cache don't have, it will talk with the RAM. So when you turn on the computer, your operating system usually load on the RAM. You got this point?
Yes.
When you turn off, the data will be vanished from the RAM. So any thoughts you want to share with about the RAM, anything? No thoughts?
Doctor?
Yes.
What you say last time?
I said many things. Wait, about what?
No, about the RAM.
I mean, the operating system usually load on the RAM.
Yes. Okay.
Because it is a you know, temporary memory. Okay, when you turn off the computer, the data will be vanished, will be deleted.
Okay.
So random access memory, the RAM, is temporary and volatile. The data will be vanished when you turn off. Types of RAM, we have static random access memory, SRAM, used for high speed registers and caches. And we have dynamic access RAM, DRAM. The normal that we are using is DRAM. Dynamic random access memory used for main memory. But in some architectures, they bring up with SRAM used for high speed registers and cache. Cache memory, a type of high speed memory that a processor can access differently than main memory. We already discussed this. It is lying between register and, it is located between register and
RAM.
So it is more faster than RAM. Okay. So it provides a fast communication. With the if CPU needs the data, so it will increase the speed. Because if CPU control unit find the data near place, so it will increase the efficiency. Otherwise, it will take a lot of time moving to the RAM, moving to the hard disk. So it takes time. You know, sometimes it's a conception like that on browser, you are writing, you are trying to open a website. Sometimes it opens very quickly. When you try to open second time, three time, did you notice this thing? Guys, are you with me?
Yes, we notice.
Why it is very fast sometimes? If you are trying to open
It has small amount of capacity, so it's stored in cache memory.
Yes, it's
if the load is going up,
you know, the browser history,
yes,
okay, cookies,
yes, also,
you know, so next time when you access, it will open very fast. But if you first time it open, because you have to open it from the server located somewhere in the country, maybe outside the country, so it will take time. So, same kind of concept here, the control unit CPU. Requires data and it is located in register or cache, so it will process, the processing speed will be very fast. Is that clear, guys?
Yes, clear, doctor.
Okay, so this is the cache memory architecture, the processor. Access this type of high-speed memory faster than main memory located on near the CPU chip. It is located on the CPU chip. Cache memory works with main memory. A cache controller determines how often the data is used, transfer frequently used data to cache memory, and then deletes the data when it goes out of use. So we have CPU here, we have main memory in front of that, right between them we have a cache mechanism. So cache memory is associated with cache controller, and you know, as its name shows, controller. So controller means the guy is going to control this memory. So there are two things written on the slide, if you can see the hit and miss. Hit means the data is available in the cache. CPU need data, it will check with the cache controller. Cache controller will check the cache memory. If data is there, so it means hit. If data is not there, it means miss. So in case of miss, they will get the data from RAM. Okay, you understand the mechanism?
Yes.
So then there are different algorithms already working behind the scene, like frequently used data, FRU, least recent used data. So there are different techniques, implemented. I hope you will learn these techniques in the course operating system. You will learn all these scheduling algorithms and these cache algorithms, page replacement algorithms. But right now you need to understand what is cache and what is the general mechanism of cache. There's a cache controller. If data is available in cache memory, it means it is hit. If it is not available, it is miss, and you have to take the data from the main memory. Okay. Is that clear, guys?
Yes.
Another type, the permanent memory. ROM is non-volatile. In case of failure, the data will be there. It is permanent storage. It provides permanent storage for data and instructions that do not change.
Not change or erase.
ROM stands for?
Read only memory.
Read only memory. You know, your BIOS, some technical instructions, these are all stored on the RAM.
It's like a Blu-ray for games or films. All of this is ROM, right?
Sorry, I didn't get you. The settings, normally the settings that are remained as it is, even after the failure of closing the system. Okay?
Okay, yes.
So we have some more concepts. These are all interrelated concepts and very important concepts for the computer as far as the processing is concerned. So very first concept is multiprocessing. The simultaneous execution of two or more instructions at the same time. Two or more instructions at the same time. You are doing 2+2, and you are also working with any other graphic tools. So there are two instructions are working at the same time. You are using calculator, you are using any other app, and one app will be working on background and one in the front, but both are working simultaneously at the same time. Their execution will be at the same time. CPU process this different applications at the same time. So this is called multiprocessing. Did you get this concept?
Yes, doctor.
The coprocessor. So we can achieve multiprocessing through different ways. One of them is coprocessor. Speeds processing. Coprocessor means your partner. The processor have other partner. Executes specific types of instructions while CPU works on another processing activity. So you have now two processors here. You have two tasks.
We have two tasks.
Yes. You are doing the painting, or maybe you are doing some other graphics. So one task may require more time. So CPU will work on that on the background, and meanwhile, CPU also working on other activity. Okay?
Yes.
So in that way, it will execute simultaneously. So multi-core microprocessor You heard this name nowadays, the it's multi-core, dual core.
Quad octa.
Quad octa, yes. So these are our microprocessors. You have many processors now. Combines two or more independent processors into a single unit. In previous slides, we discussed the one CPU. Now multi-core means we have more than one CPU. So this is gonna be a fast, very fast. Some instructions will be done by CPU A, some instruction done by CPU B. Okay, or sometimes maybe one instruction is distributed between two. And that is called parallel computing, the simultaneous execution of same task on multiple processors to obtain. You have two processors, you have one task, and you divided the one task into different processors. Did you get this point, guys?
A bit, doctor.
The parallel computing means you have multiple processors, but you have one task. So one task is divided by among multiple processors. Like I gave you the assignment, when you have five students, you will divide the assignment, so assignment will be finished very quickly.
The screen is freezing.
Okay.
Now you can see slide.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the processing is, you know, very slow. So it means the CPU is busy.
Yeah.
Okay. So now, what is parallel computing? For example, I give you the assignment, and your assignment is divided among five students. So you can complete assignment very quickly. Am I right? Okay. But in parallel computing, the same task is given to multiple processors to obtain the results faster. Is that clear, guys?
Yes.
So next concept is grid computing. It is the same kind of concepts, but the difference is it is on the network. A collection of computers working in coordinated manner to solve a common problem. Collection of computers, maybe 10 computers, 20 computers, they are on network and their resources can be shared so they can solve the problem very quickly. Got the point? When I say the shared resources, which means they can share the memory, they can share the speed, okay, they can divide the task on network. So this is called grid computing. So we discussed different concepts: multiprocessing, coprocessor, multi-core processor, parallel computing, grid computing. So the results, the output or the desired or the required task is same from all these concepts. To solve the problem faster, to get the result faster, okay? Is that clear, guys?
Yes.
Okay, next topic is secondary storage. All of you know what is secondary storage: your hard drive, external devices for storage. The amount of data that companies store digitally is increasing at a rate of close to 10% per year. You know, nowadays...
Doctor?
Yes?
Please.
So this is a processing problem. Okay. In first point, it says the amount of data that companies store digitally is increasing at a rate of close to 100% per year. Do you agree with this? Your data is increasing 100% per year. Why it is freezing just with me? I'm sitting in the college. Maybe this is the processing issue on the network. So guys, you can hear my voice. Do you agree with this? Your data rate is increasing 100% 10 year per year.
Can you explain what per year?
You know the data that companies store digitally. Every company is storing data. So that data is increasing every year, 100%, double.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, it is the era of big data. Have you heard the name big data? A large amount of data coming from...
Like a database.
Like a database, but it is the database of the databases. Big data. It's not a data. Thousands of databases.
Okay.
Data is coming. Large data is coming from the variety of sources with the large velocity nowadays. You know, data is the one company, you know, storing a huge amount of data. The data in, you know, every company has social media pages. They have Facebook page, they have account on Twitter, they have account on Snapchat, they have account on Instagram. So they are posting on daily basis and the people are communicating, buying and purchasing. So it's a huge data for one company. So imagine you have the thousands of companies and where they are going to store that data. Got my point?
Yes, yes, doctor. What's his name? They connect with the one servers, or what?
Sorry, I didn't get your point.
The all of application. They connect on one server.
No, they have, you know, many servers. You know, the Facebook have city of servers. They have a city of server, thousands of server. Just the Facebook. Imagine the Amazon, Google, Microsoft, and all the big giants. It's a huge data. So there are different kind of storage, we will discuss this, so, but right now we are discussing, but you need to understand the data is increasing with rapidly speed. That's why the term data, big data is introduced, and the data scientists, there are a lot of jobs nowadays for them. They use the machine learning and artificial intelligence, many things to manage the data. So our topic is secondary storage. As you know, the hard disk, the permanent storage, allows organization to store large amount of data and instruction more permanently than main memory. We have already discussed what is main memory. So this is secondary storage that's stored permanently. Compared with main memory, secondary storage offers the advantages of non-volatility. So your data will not be vanished, will remain there. Greater capacity, more size, and greater economy, price-wise, it is cheap as compared to the internal storage. Okay. So if we discuss the different storage devices, So here, how to access the data from these storages? So with their different method to access the data, CPU, how the CPU can access the data from hard disk, from main memory. So there are different methods for accessing the data. The first one is sequential and direct access. Sequential, as you know, in order, steps 1, 2, 3, 4, one by one. Data must be retrieved in order in which it is stored. You know the FIFO and LIFO concepts?
No.
First in, first out.
Ah, yeah. I know this one.
So data come first, will go out first. LIFO, last in, will go first. Last in, first out. So there are different.
Alhamdulillah.
Okay, so there are different techniques used, different algorithms used in accessing the method. So sequential method, the data must be retrieved in order, first out, in which it is stored. Okay, devices used are called sequential storage devices. And the second method is direct access. Records can be retrieved in any order. Devices used are called direct access storage. Any order, regardless of data position. If you need data, you can directly go to the position and you can take the data. So you must have address of the data. Have you heard the linked list? Any student have idea about linked list? You know, the different data structures, FIFO, we have, the LIFO that I discussed already, and there's also a linked list. So you have the address of where the data is stored. So you can directly, if you have the address, you can directly access the data. So that is called direct access. So these are two different access methods normally used in different device storage devices. Magnetic tapes, it's a sequential secondary storage medium, primarily for storing backups or critical organizer. You know, the magnetic tape, it's a kind of a heavy, it's kind of a, how can I explain this one? Have you heard the magnetic tapes? It's just like, the hard disk, but it's a little bit heavy. So they are normally used for backup of the organization's data. Magnetic disk, direct access storage. If you open the hard disk, you have it works in sectors, in circles there. Have you heard these things? Sectors inside the CD-ROM or the hard disk, how the data is read. They are circular disk, and the header will read the data in that. So we have a different type of storage devices. Magnetic tapes is uses the sequential access method. You need to know this. Magnetic disk is using direct access. So there are different techniques used in these storage devices. Optical secondary storage devices, I hope you are familiar with these things. The CD-ROM, the storage capacity is 740. So read-only memory. So there are different read-write memory, the write memory, so different privileges in CD-ROM. Then you have a DVD. So it has more capacity, 6 times capacity of CD-ROM. And the third one is Blu-ray high definition video disc. This is even bigger in terms of capacity, 3 times capacity of DVD.
Doctor, last one, what is, I don't know what. Blu-ray.
It's Blu-ray high definition video disc. Video data normally stored in that. Okay?
Like DVD or?
Like the PlayStation CDs.
Yes.
That kind is called
Blu-ray. Because that is more, you know, advanced, more capacity, with more capacity. Because for games, you know, you need to store a graphic data, which is quite heavy. Okay, so you need a more capacity. So as you can see, the 3 times, you know, more than DVD.
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes.
A Blu-ray also called ROM, or it's like ROM because we cannot written on it, only read.
No, I didn't get your point.
Blu-ray, we can classify the Blu-ray like a ROM memory, because it's only read only. We can't written or edit the data inside the Blu-ray.
Because the information is burnt into the CD.
Yes.
I think that's what he is trying to say.
Yes. It's a digital optical disc data storage format designed to supersede the DVD format, capable of storing several hours of video in high definition.
Okay.
Like feature films, PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4, Xbox One, all these can be, you know, stored here. Used to read the disk, which allows information to be stored at a greater density. You can also write. There is a write mechanism in this, not only read. Okay, is that clear?
Okay, yes, yes.
Okay, so moving next, so we have further storage devices, solid state drive, SSD, store data in memory chips rather than magnetic or optical media, have few moving parts, so they are less fragile than hard disk, you know, like USB, you're using the USB, or sometimes, you know, the memory card also, small memory card. Can also be part here, so they are more faster and, you know, less fragile. There's no, yes, flash memory, so there is less chance for getting something difficult for the system. You know, nowadays the modern laptops, they are not providing you know the CD-ROM or the RJ45 port. Did you notice this? There are few ports, there are very less ports in the latest.
Yes.
Because they don't want any hassle in that. So they are encouraging you to use the external, you know, connectors with that.
Oh.
They have the capabilities, they can use it, but you need to connect with something. Okay?
Yes.
So disadvantage of SSD, high cost per GB of data storage. Yes, you cannot store the large data in that. Lower capacity compared to current hard drives. Yes, we know this. Okay, this is the last concept for today's lecture. Attached, so you have a different option for storage. So far we discussed the devices. Now we are talking about the enterprise level, the organization level, how the organization are managing these storage mechanism. So the first one is attached storage, the devices discussed before, attached to a single computer. Okay, this is very clear, everybody knows. The second one, network attached storage. Now the network is there. Computers are connected with each other. Storage devices that attach to a network instead of to a single computer. So over the network, they can store somewhere. Storage area network, similar to the network attached storage, except there is a dedicated special purpose high speed network that provides direct connection between data storage devices and computer across the enterprise. So both are same. So what is the difference is, in storage area network, they have specialized network whose working is only provide the help in storage mechanism. Okay, and the figure will give you the more idea. This is storage area network. This is the specialized created network. Okay, these storage devices or these computers cannot directly use these devices. They must go through this network. Okay, whereas in network attached, the storage devices that attached to a network instead of a single. So computers can access these over the network. Okay. But in SAN, storage area network, they have specialized network that is only working for the storage devices. Did you get this point, guys? What is the difference between network attached storage and storage area network? Purpose is same, storage, but mechanism is little bit different. In SAN, by the way, IBM is using this storage area network. Okay, guys, can you hear my voice? Are you with me?
Yes, yes.
Yes, Dr.
Okay, so there is another type which is not mentioned here. Is the slide is not here for that. But I will tell you the storage as a service. You know, the many companies are providing you the space online. You can pay money, you can and you can use the storage like cloud. Yes, like you know the GoDaddy.com. You can purchase the domain. You can find the domain. Like Amazon is providing this. Google. Also providing this, Microsoft, so all the big giants actually providing the space. You can purchase the space from them. You can rent a space. Okay, so that is called storage as a service. So we discussed three concepts here today. The first one is the attached storage. Everybody knows this, like we are using it at home. Secondly, network attached storage. Now your storage is on network and computers can access the resources memory on network. SAN is specialized, special purpose high speed network. It's dedicated special purpose high speed network that provides direct connections between data storage devices and computers, as we can see in the figure. And the third one is storage as a service, like cloud, like we can rent the space. Okay, guys, so this is the last slide for today. So we have 8-9 slides, so we can finish in the next lecture.